الحمد لله رب العالمين وافضل الصلاه واتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى اله واصحابه اجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا ارحم الراحمين. Allah teach us what benefit us, increase us in knowledge, in good morals and in good detail of the alameen. So we continue by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings commenting on Surat Al-Kahf, and we are still on ayah 8 where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the reality of this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the reality of this life and that it is temporary life, that it will never last. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Surely we have made whatever is on the earth as adornment and as beautification or ornament for it, so that we test them who are the best in doing the good deeds. Then he said subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. Then surely we will make whatever on it, whatever is on it, we will reduce it to barren ground. صَعِيدًا means a land that is level, that is flat, that doesn't have any mountains, any shade, any trees, anything. And Jeruza means no plants in it. So Allah will reduce it to barren ground. All this earth with all of its buildings, with the mountains, with all of those waterfalls, all of those natural scenes, everything on it will be reduced to barren ground. One of the nice ayat in the Quran that also talk about the reality of this life is Surah Al-Qasas chapter 28, ayah 60 and 61. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَمَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتُهَا وَمَا عِندَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, whatever you have been given of this life, whatever you have been given in this life is only a fleeting enjoyment. Is a fleeting enjoyment, means it's temporary enjoyment. It will not last forever. It is the fleeting enjoyment of this world and its adornment and its ornament, its decoration. Then he says, and whatever is with Allah is far better and more lasting. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for the believers is far better and more lasting. Then he says, will you not then understand? أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Will you not reflect? Will you not think? Then he said subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very nice ayah, أَفَمَنْ وَعَدْنَاهُ وَعْدًا حَسَنًا فَهُوَ لَاقِيهِ كَمَنْ مَتَّعْنَاهُ مَتَاعَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا ثُمَّ هُوَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنَ الْمُحْضَرِينَ. Is the one who has been promised a good promise, then he will get it and it will be fulfilled for him. Is he, means Jannah, means the believers who do the good deeds and they are promised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get Jannah, to get paradise. Is that type of person like the one whom we allow to enjoy the pleasures of the worldly life, then on the day of judgment he will be of those who will be brought for punishment and for judgment. Is this similar to this? Of course they are not similar. SubhanAllah. A very nice and blessed ayah that those who do the good deeds and they are promised to get the eternal happiness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are not comparable to those who are enjoying some worldly pleasures in this life and then they will be brought for the punishment on the day of judgment. And this is why our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cautioned us so that we are aware of this life and we are prepared for this life. He said in the authentic hadith, Al-kayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'da al-maut. A mindful person, a smart person is the one who brings himself to account and who works for what comes after death. While the disabled one is the one who just follows his own desires. He follows his own desires and he keeps wishing and wishing. He's indulged only in wishfulness. He doesn't prepare any deeds. He just says Allah is forgiving, Allah is merciful, but he doesn't show any actions and doesn't prepare anything to deserve that mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الدُّنْيَا حُلْوَةٌ خَضِرَةٌ. This worldly life is sweet and green and attractive. And Allah has entrusted you in it. And entrusted you with it. He made you trustees on this earth. And He will see how you're going to do. فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا. So avoid the dunya. اتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا means put a shield between you and the dunya. Put a shield between you and this worldly life. When you say اتَّقُوا اللَّهُ means put a shield between you and the torment or the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say اتَّقُوا النَّارُ means put a shield between you and the hellfire. Here اتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا, put a shield between you and the worldly life. Doesn't mean you don't go to work. No, it means put a shield between this worldly life and your heart. You don't let it go into your heart. You don't let it control your heart. You don't make it your main concern. As our beloved صلى الله عليه وسلم made in the dua, اللهم لا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا. Oh Allah, do not make this worldly life our main concern, our biggest concern. No, you use this worldly life to take from it for the hereafter and to prepare for your eternal life. And our beloved said صلى الله عليه وسلم in the hadith narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi, إِنَّ مَوْضِعَ سَوْطٍ فِي الْجَنَّةِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. The place of a whip in Jannah means just few feet or less than few feet is better than the whole world and all what it contains. SubhanAllah. So how can we leave and compromise the eternal happiness and the eternal paradise and the Jannah that is incomparable to the worldly life? How can we compare it and how can we compromise it just for some desires? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after telling us about this life, He explains and He starts telling us the summary of the people, of the story of the people of Al-Kahf. أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا إِذْ أَوَى الْفِتْيَةُ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا فضربنا على آذانهم في الكهف سنين عددا ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا. Subhanallah, the connection between these two ayat and the people of Al-Kahf or their story is very nice here. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that here are some examples of some people who also were tested the same test. They were rich people, they had a very good life, but they chose the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over their worldly pleasures. They preferred the hereafter, they preferred worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. They were not deceived by this worldly life and its adornment and its zina and its ornament. No, they succeeded, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us this example to show us that those great people, the youth of Al-Kahf, they were among the successful ones. Even though they have desires, just like all other people, and they even have more desires and stronger desires, as the case with the youth, generally speaking, that the youth have their desires at the utmost level, and still they succeeded in that test. They preferred Allah's pleasure over their own desires. And they struggled and they left their houses, they left their homes, they left the richness they had and they enjoyed to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made miracles for them, as we will read in the coming ayat, inshaAllah. So this life is a test. As these ayat are summarized, that this life is a test, is ibtila. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put desires in every one of us. He put tendencies or inclinations or desires towards the other gender, towards money, towards dunya, towards fame, towards so many different things, food, drink, etc. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not put these desires in us so that He will torture us with these desires. Not at all. Allah wants us to fulfill these desires, but in the right way, in the right time, in the right manner. And this is the test. If you use these desires within the limits and the boundaries and the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will succeed. And you will enjoy it here and you will get the eternal happiness there in the hereafter. But if you want to enjoy it and fulfill it in the way you like and the time you like and without limitations, then you will fail and you will be among the rebellious ones and you will lose the eternal happiness of the hereafter. So this is the whole test. It's about struggling against your own desires and being a servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not being a servant to your own desires, as Allah mentions in the Quran. أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَى. Do you see the one who took his own God, his own egos and desires as his God? So here is the challenge and here is the choice. And subhanAllah, usually our egos, we don't like limitations. We don't like to be limited. We just like to enjoy the way we like, without limitations, without do's and don'ts, without... And here's the challenge. If you obey your own soul, your own self, your own desires, you will fail. And if you obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will succeed. 8 ayat talking about the reality of this worldly life, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts telling us the story of the people of the cave after whom this surah has been named, Surat Al-Kahf. It's named after the cave of who? The cave of those young people who resorted to that cave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after these two ayat, He starts this story or the summary of this story in 4 verses. 9 and 10 and 11 and 12. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after that explains in detail, in some details, the story of those young men. And we mentioned the connection between these two ayat and the people of Al-Kahf, as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, here are some young men. Fitya means young men. The people of Al-Kahf were young men. They were not like old and wise people who have experience in life. No, they're young. And what that means, the young people have their desires at its utmost measure, right? They are in their top desires. They have stronger desires for everything, for money, for world, for the other gender, for. Right? Because that is the strongest stage of life. The youth. Right? And this is mentioned in the Quran in many ayat, by the way. That this is the strongest and the best and the greatest stage of your life is your youth. Once you become very old, you're not going to have that strength. Even your desires will become less. But when you are in your utmost desires, if that's right, in the stage where you have the utmost and the strongest desires, and despite that you prefer to obey Allah, that is the greatest example, that is the greatest challenge. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is setting for us this story, that even though these were young men who love this world and who have the energy of the youth and the love for this world and for its desires, still they prefer to obey Allah, they prefer to worship Allah alone, and they left their luxury, they left their richness, and they left their families, and they left their land and people, and just went out running away to protect their religion because they were not ready and they didn't accept to follow the pagan Roman emperor that was in their time, who wanted to impose paganism and idol worship on them and associating partners with them, with Allah on them. They preferred to follow the message of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, who called people to worship Allah alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. So some scholars, they say they lived almost 250 years after Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, after Jesus. So they learned from the message of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam. So they were on the right tawheed. They believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one creator, the one God, and they believed Sayyidina Isa was a messenger from God, etc. And they had the right belief. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, أَمْ حَسِدْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. Have you thought that the people of the cave and the plaque, أَمْ حَسِدْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ. الرقيم, الكهف is the cave, we know. This hole in the mountain, right? And that doesn't have an end, or it's not open, it's open only from one side. And al-raqim is the plaque in which their names and their story was inscribed. And it was hanged or hung on the entrance of the cave. That is al-raqim. So Allah is saying subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, ayah 9. Do you think that the people of the cave and the plaque were the only wonders of our signs, or that they were no more or greater wonders from among our signs? Do you think that these were their story, or that the signs in their story were the greatest signs that we have? Means what? Means no. Means this is only like one of the, if you like, the little normal wonders that Allah can make, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is what? Which is protecting those youth in the cave and making them sleep for 300 years. 309 years. Without anything harming them. Without any animal harming them. Without even the sun touching them. Without any harm in their bodies. Do you think that is the only wonder from among the signs and the wonders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's signs? No. And this shows us, dear brothers, that when you resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as those youth did, Allah changes the world for you. Allah changes the sun. Allah changes everything for them. Everything that will make them rest and take the utmost comfort, you find in your sleep. The utmost comfort. They're not feeling any pain, they're not thinking, they don't have any worries, any concern, they're just resting for those 309 years. Then Allah resurrected them, brought them back to life, unharmed. To show, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, to show people is a great sign. And to show who will really know and realize how much and how long those young people spent in their cave. أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. إِذْ أَوَى الْفِتْيَةُ, when those young men, when the young man resorts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is one of the dearest things to Allah. One of the most beloved things to Allah is that a young man who is in his full energy, where his desires are at its utmost level, he resorts to Allah and he connects his heart with Allah and he comes to the masajid and he comes to the circles of knowledge and the circles of dhikr and he maintains his prayers and he's not indulged in haram relations and in haram stuff. That is one of the most beloved things to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one of the categories of people who will be given shade on the day of judgment. Allah will give them shade from the sun when he is given or shown the desires and he rejects them out of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the hadith about those categories of people where a beautiful girl will come and try to seduce them, but they will say, I fear Allah. I fear Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves so much those who repent to him, but he loves the youth who repent to him more, because they are more subject to desires, right? They're more subject to desires. Their desires and tendencies and energy are at its
utmost level, highest level still when they return to Allah. So that is one of the dearest things to Allah and most beloved things to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In awal fityatu ila al-kahfi, when the young men resorted to the cave, saying, our Lord, Rabbana, this word is the dearest name to the believer. Rabbana is the nearest and the dearest word should be to you as a believer. If you understand this word, what it means, the Rabb is the one who raises you up, is the one who takes care of you in every second, in every breath, in every heartbeat. That is your Rabb, who's taking care of you, who created you and maintaining you and sustaining you and nurturing you every second and every breath. That is your Rabb, who loves you and who cares for you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِن لَّدُنكَ رَحْمًا. Grant us mercy from yourself. We don't want from anyone else. From you, Ya Rabb, give us mercy. Have mercy on us. Protect us from our people who are chasing us, who want to force us to worship other than you. آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. And guide us rightly through our ordeal. Give us the right way. Guide us to the way that will lead us to your pleasure, to your paradise, to your eternal happiness. آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا. Then we cast a cover of deep sleep over their ears in the cave for many years. فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ. We caused them to sleep and to fall into a deep sleep for many years in the cave. Then what? ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ. Then we raised them up. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ. We raised them, so that we may show which of the two groups would make the better estimation of the length of their stay in the cave. ثُمَّ بَعْثْنَاهُمْ لِنَعْلَمَ أَيُّ الْحِزْبَيْنِ أَحْصَى لِمَا لَبِثُوا أَمَدًا. In these four ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if He's summarizing for us the story, showing us briefly showing us that wonder and that miracle. That is a miracle. That is a miracle. That is called in Arabic, in the science of Aqidah, the scholars call it Karama. Karama. And for the prophets, they call it Mu'jiza. Anything that is unnatural. Anything that breaks the norm. Anything that breaks the norm. It's not normal that someone sleeps for 309 years, then he gets up and he lives his life. It's not normal at all, right? There are animals, there are beasts, there's the sun, there are so many things that will prevent this from happening. But here is the wonder and the sign and the miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also it is showing that disbelievers, the pagans in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who used to deny resurrection, they used to disbelieve in resurrection after death. So this surah, which was revealed in Mecca before the migration of the Prophet ﷺ, came to show, to answer a question that those pagans asked, and they tried to test the Prophet ﷺ's knowledge, and Allah brought him the answer, and is showing them, just as I raised those youth after 309 years, I can raise you after whatever years you die. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Qadir. He is the one who is able to do everything and the one who controls everything. And this surah and this story with the many stories in this surah, Surah Al-Kahf, particularly the story of the youth of Al-Kahf, came also to give kind of consolement or consolation or comfort to the Muslims in early Islam, in Mecca, where they used to be persecuted. Right? The Meccans, the pagans, they wanted to force the believers, the Muslims, to leave Islam and to worship the idols. And they were, you know, persecuting them, torturing them. We know the story of Sayyidina Bilal, the story of Sayyidina Ammar, the story of Sayyidina Khabbab, the story of Sumayya radiallahu anha, the first martyr in Islam, who was a female, the mother of Sayyidina Ammar. We know how much torture and persecution they received. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them, don't worry. Just have patience. as I have given refuge and protection and made wonders to the people and the youth of the cave, I can do the same for you. And this is what Allah did, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He facilitated to them the migration to Al-Madinah, and they established their state. And just few years, they came back conquering Mecca. And all of the Meccans submitted to this religion without shedding any blood, peacefully. Our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back with his sahaba, with his companions, conquering that land. And the fulfillment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sign was very clear, but it needed what? A lot of patience, dear brothers, a lot of struggle, a lot of jihad, struggle and strife against their desires, against their own wishes. They showed so much patience until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them relief. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to follow the footsteps of those great people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who listen to the speech and follow its best. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
Assalamu alaikum.